Good morning. It's good to see all of you in God's house this morning. I hope you've come today expecting a blessing from the Lord. And if that's the way you've come, then you will. We're glad to see all of you, especially if we have any first-time guests with us here today. If that be you, we especially welcome you and ask that you would fill out the welcome card attached to your bulletin. And then when they pass the offering plate, just drop it in there so we'll have a record of your visit with us today. In your bulletin, again, revival insert, some little devotion thing on one side, and on the back we have a schedule of our home prayer meetings. We hope that you, if you can make them all, that'd be great, but we hope that you can make one or two of them anyway. Because folks, I want to tell you, that's the key to revival is prayer. And so I appreciate those of you who have opened up your home for these meetings. We so appreciate you being hosts for these. So please, please make plans to join us in our home prayer meetings. Carol and I want to thank you for just many acts of kindness and words of kindness that you've shown to us. And we very, very much appreciate you. You have shown appreciation to us, but I'm very humbled by that. But we appreciate you so much and love you so very much. We enjoyed last night eating a meal together with a whole bunch of you. But we cannot say thank you enough. Words can't really say how much we appreciate you. And we just want you to know that. Would you bow with me as we pray together this morning? Our gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we are just in awe of you. God, I just want to thank you so much for loving us so much that you would send Jesus, your only Son, to suffer and die for us, to take our punishment for our sins upon himself, making possible a home in heaven for whosoever will believe in him and accept him as their personal Savior and Lord. Father, today we just pray that your Holy Spirit would work in our midst. I pray, Lord, that you would just take charge of every part of this service. I pray that if there's somebody here today who's never accepted Jesus Christ as their Savior, Lord, I pray that your Holy Spirit would draw them to salvation this day. I pray for Christians who walked into this place today feeling discouraged, maybe even feeling they're in a hopeless situation. God, I pray that you would speak to them today. God, all things are possible with you. And we're just so thankful to be able to worship you and serve you this day. Lead us and guide us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's all stand as we sing Crown Him with Many Crowns.
Crown him with many crowns, the Lamb upon his throne. Hark how the heavenly anthems drown all music but its own. Awake my soul and sing of him who died for thee, and hail him as thy matchless king through all eternity. Crown him the Lord of life, who triumphed o'er the grave, and rose victorious in the strife for those he came to save. His glories now we sing, who died and rose on high, who died eternal life may bring on life. Crown him the Lord of love, behold his hands and side, those wounds yet visible above, in glory glorified. All hail, Redeemer, hail, for thou hast died for me, thy praise and glory shall not fail throughout eternity.
Thank you. You may be seated.
Well, good morning, everyone. It's good to see you all this morning. Want to highlight just a couple of announcements in the bulletin. Lots of things coming up in the next few days and weeks. Today, there are several meetings happening this afternoon. The music and sound committees will meet at 4:30. The finance committee will be meeting at 5. And also, parents of middle and high school youth, I'd like to meet with you guys at 5 today up in the second floor jam room. Just a brief meeting to update you on a few things coming up next year. Also want to make mention, Trunk or Treat is coming up on Saturday. This coming Saturday, we're in need of candy, and I've got a lot of people signed up to help, but we can always use more. So looking forward to that big event, and just reaching out to a lot of folks in our community during that time. Also want to make mention, if you'll note on the back of your bulletin, there's a little note from Project JFK. A lot of you know we are not able to host the Blanket America coat distribution this year due to funding and things on their end that have taken place this year. But we have at Kennedy received a lot of calls asking about that, and I know the church has received some calls. So because of this, we're going to have a coat drive between now and November 8th. If you have any coats that your children have outgrown, or if you just want to pick one up at Walmart or somewhere, children's size coat, we're going to collect those and be placing them up on outside the elevator on the second floor. And after November 8th, we'll take those up to the school, and we'll distribute those to students who are in need, and also coordinate with our family resource centers. So just really appreciate this church on behalf of Kennedy, all that it does with Project JFK, just all the things throughout the year. I can't tell you how much it means to us. And this morning, if you'll indulge me for just a minute, I wanted to show just a short video clip. Just so you can see some of the faces of the children this church helps. And after the video, I'm going to turn things over to Joe for another announcement.
Like a small boat on the ocean, sending big waves into motion, like how a single word can make a heart open. I might only have one match, but I can make an explosion. And all those things I did.
Take that.
on the ocean, sending big waves into motion, like how a single word can make a heart open. I might only have one match, but I can make an explosion. This is my fight song. Take back my life.
I believe there's a lot of us could relate to a lot of those scenes in there, either our children, grandchildren, and especially ourselves. I'll call your attention to a poem that's in your bulletin, and we're going to do it as a responsive reading for our honor of our pastor. Who is the one we look to most, and who is always at his post? Who always greets us with a smile and makes us feel that life's worthwhile.
Our pastor.
Who listens to our ups and downs and knows our faults but never frowns. Who never mentions his own cares, his troubles silently he bears.
Our pastor.
Who comes to see us when we're ill and helps to cure but sends no bill. Who marries off our lass and lad and comforts us when death makes sad?
Our pastor.
Who studies far into the night and seeks God's will with all his might? Who thinks of others, not himself? Who works for souls and not for wealth?
Our pastor.
For the last year, he's been our guide, our shepherd, always by our side. He helps us feel that he is near and that we have no need to fear. The one who helps him most is she whose life from service is not free. She makes her life a part of his loyalty. Her husband is
our pastor.
So we would honor them today and in a very special way thank them for what they've done and been and thank God for this man of men.
Our pastor.
And we truly thank you, Rick and Carolyn. It's been a wonderful ride for the past year, and we hope and pray we have many more to come, just like it. It's been encouraging. It's commendable to the church family, to the pulpit committee, for everyone's patience in waiting, seeking out God's man that we truly did find. And we thank both of you. The flowers are here in their honor today, because today is their day.
Let's all remain standing as we fellowship and shake hands with one another. Let's all sing, "Shall We Gather at the River?"
Shall we gather at the river where bright angel feet have trod, with its crystal tide forever flowing by the throne of God? Yes, we'll gather at the river, the beautiful river. Gather with the saints at the river that flows by the throne of God. On the margin of the river, washing up its silver spray, we will walk and worship ever all the happy golden day. Yes, we'll gather at the river, the beautiful river. Gather with the saints at the river that flows by the throne of God. Ere we reach the shining river, lay we every burden down. Grace our spirits will deliver and provide a robe and crown. Yes, we'll gather at the river, the beautiful river. Gather with the saints at the river that flows by the throne of God. Soon we'll reach the shining river, noon now crystal peace, when our happy hearts will quiver with the melody of peace. Yes, we'll gather at the river, the beautiful river. Gather with the saints at the river that flows by the throne of God.
Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you so much, Lord, for this wonderful Sabbath that you've given us and the opportunity to be in your house again, Lord. Lord, we're thankful for this church and all the blessings you've bestowed on it. And Lord, I cannot pray without praying, Lord, for our country. It seems like our leaders are chipping away at the very foundation of our country and Christianity. Lord, we're thankful that you sent Brother Rick and Carolyn to this church, giving us such a blessing. And Lord, I pray as Brother Rick brings your message that you'll be with him. Now, Lord, we have an opportunity to give back to you just a portion of what you've so graciously given us. And we pray that it'll be used in the upbuilding of your kingdom. For these things I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
please. Avery, I think you just scared those flowers. All right. Good morning, guys. How's everybody doing? Good? I got a question for you this morning. When you get in trouble, let's say that you fall off your bicycle or you're out on the playground, you get hit in the head with a football, and it really hurts. What's the first thing you do?
Cry.
Cry. Yep. Fall on the ground, scream. I had a kid this week. We were out at recess, and he jumped up in the air trying to catch a football and didn't do so hot coming back down and ended up doing a rather perfect split when he came down. You know what the first thing he did was? Mr. Walters, help! That's usually our first reaction when we're in trouble, when we've got something going on and we need help. And this happened with somebody in the Bible. And his name was Bartimaeus. And as Jesus and his disciples were leaving Jericho, they heard this man start crying out, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." So he needed help, guys, because he had been blind from birth, never been able to see. But his crying out got on the nerves of all the people around him. And they started saying, "Be quiet, you're bothering us." But he would only shout louder because he knew the one who could help him was there. "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." When Jesus heard Bartimaeus crying out, he stopped and he said, "Tell him to come to me." So they called the blind man. "Cheer up," they said. "Come on, Jesus is calling you to come over." So Bartimaeus jumped up, threw aside his coat, and went to Jesus. And Jesus asked him, "What do you want me to do for you?" Bartimaeus answered, "I want to see." "Go," Jesus said, "your faith has healed you." And instantly, blind Bartimaeus could see, and he followed Jesus as they traveled on down the road. And guys, this is a lesson for us. When we have a need, God's not going to ignore it. God loves us and wants what's best for us. The Bible tells us in Philippians chapter 4, verse 6, "Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need, and be sure to thank him for what he's done for you." So when you're having troubles or issues or things that are going on in life, we need to remember, who's the one that's going to take care of us? God, exactly. So let's pray together before you guys go to Children's Church. Father, we are so grateful that you are there for us always, and you know our needs before we even know them. Help us to remember that we need not worry about anything. All we need to do is ask of you in Jesus' name. We thank you and love you and praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Front pew, feel free to come at this time as we go to the Lord in prayer.
Our Heavenly Father, we so humbly come to you, Lord, this morning, thanking you, Lord, for all the many blessings, thanking you, Lord, for all you provide. Lord, we are a blessed nation, but as Bill prayed, sometimes we wonder what's going on. Lord, we know that we can come to you in prayer. We can bring our petitions, our concerns. As we studied in Sunday school this morning, praying fervently, Lord, help us all to come to you. Help us all to stay connected. And most of all, Lord, help us all to pray expectantly. Erase any doubt, Lord, in us that we might have when we ask. You said ask and it will be provided. Lord, we just thank you so much for our church. Thank you for each one that takes a part, from our pastor right down, Lord, to that person that sits back there in the corner that comes to hear your word. We're so thankful for all of these. Lord, we just pray that you'll just continue to be with us. We pray for our revival. As we talked in Sunday school this morning, Lord, if one person walks right up here and accepts you as their Savior, it has been a great revival. And Lord, we pray expectantly. Now go with us today. Be with Rick as he stands before us. And Lord, may we take his word and use it in our lives. And most of all, Lord, as we leave, may we all say, it's been good to be in the house of the Lord. For we ask it in thy name. Amen.
Let's all stand as we sing, Jesus, Keep Me Near the Cross.
Jesus, keep me near the cross. There a precious fountain, all a healing stream flows from Calvary's mountain. In the cross, be my glory ever, till my ransomed soul shall find rest beyond the river. Near the cross, a trembling soul, love and mercy found me. There the bright and morning star shed his beams around me. In the cross, be my glory ever, till my ransomed soul shall find rest beyond the river. Near the cross, O Lamb of God, it seems before me. Help me walk from day to day with its shadow o'er me. In the cross, be my glory ever, till my ransomed soul shall find rest beyond the river. Near the cross I'll watch and wait, hoping, trusting ever, till that golden strand just beyond the river. In the cross, be my glory ever, till my ransomed soul shall find rest beyond the river.
Thank you. You may be seated.
All right, if you have your Bibles this morning, will you turn with me in the Old Testament to the book of Ezekiel? The book of Ezekiel. We're going to read the first three verses of that book in chapter 1, and then we're turning over to chapter 37 as we ask a question: can these bones live? Can these bones live? It's amazing to me. Halloween coming up. I was reading the other day that they're doing a tour somewhere through cemetery. Halloween, you know, I don't know. I guess some people get a kick out of that. Graveyards are usually not most people's favorite places to be, but for us as believers, it shouldn't bother us. It's going to be a sight of great victory one day when the Lord Jesus Christ returns, and those graves that contains believers are going to burst open. It is a sight of victory for us as Christians. But that's where our text is taking us today, to a graveyard, if you will. So let's look in Ezekiel chapter 1, first of all, and then we'll turn over to chapter 37. Now it came to pass in the 30th year, in the fourth month, in the fifth day of the month, as I was among the captives by the river of Kabar, that the heavens were opened and I saw visions of God. In the fifth day of the month, which was the fifth year of King Jehoiakim's captivity, the word of the Lord came expressly unto Ezekiel the priest, the son of Buzi, in the land of the Chaldeans by the river Kabar. And the hand of the Lord was there upon him. Chapter 37, beginning at verse 1. The hand of the Lord was upon me and carried me out in the spirit of the Lord, and set me down in the midst of the valley which was full of bones, and caused me to pass by them round about. And behold, there were very many in the open valley, and lo, they were very dry. And he said unto me, Son of man, can these bones live? And I answered, O Lord God, thou knowest. Again he said unto me, Prophesy upon these bones, and say unto them, O ye dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus saith the Lord God unto these bones, Behold, I will cause breath to enter into you, and you shall live. And I will lay sinews upon you, and will bring a flesh upon you, and cover you with skin, and put breath in you, and you shall live. And ye shall know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I was commanded. And as I prophesied, there was a noise, and behold, a shaking. And the bones came together, bone to his bone. And when I beheld, lo, the sinews and the flesh came upon them, and the skin covered them above, but there was no breath in them. Then said he unto me, Prophesy unto the wind, prophesy, son of man, and say to the wind, Thus saith the Lord God, Come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe upon these slain, that they may live. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they lived and stood up upon their feet, an exceeding great army. Then he said unto me, Son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. Behold, they say, Our bones are dried, and our hope is lost. We are cut off for our parts. Therefore prophesy and say unto them, Thus saith the Lord God, Behold, O my people, I will open your graves and cause you to come up out of your graves and bring you into the land of Israel. And ye shall know that I am the Lord when I have opened your graves, O my people, and brought you up out of your graves, and shall put my spirit in you, and you shall live, and I shall place you in your own land. Then shall ye know that I, the Lord, have spoken it and performed it, saith the Lord. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for your holy word. And Lord, I know there is power in your word. I thank you for the working of your Holy Spirit in our midst. I know there's power in the working of your Holy Spirit. And Lord, I just pray today that, Lord, if there's anyone here who is not right with you, Lord, I especially pray for that lost person. God, I just pray that they would understand the hopeless situation they're in right now apart from Jesus. But how you're here, ready, able, and willing to save them if they would just call out to you. But Lord, I pray for Christians who may be here, and for whatever reason, Lord, they may feel they're in a hopeless situation as well. Lord, I just pray that you would just give them a word of assurance, encouragement, and promise today that you're still on the throne. Lord, use me, your servant, for your glory and your purpose for this time. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. In 586 BC, Jerusalem, including the temple, was totally destroyed by Nebuchadnezzar and his Babylonian army. All the inhabitants of Jerusalem at that time were taken either to Chaldea or to Babylon in captivity. Now, their nation's history had begun by miraculous delivery by God from the cruel hands of the Egyptians under Pharaoh. And now, because of their disobedience, they are in captivity once again. The psalmist records, "By the rivers of Babylon, we sat down and we wept." Ezekiel added his own lament to this bleak situation when he recorded in that first verse we read in chapter 1, "I was among the captives by the river of Kabar." Now, historians tell us that Ezekiel was probably around 25 years of age when he was taken into captivity. He had been in training to become a priest in that temple in Jerusalem. Now, Jewish law provided that a man could not enter the priesthood until he was 30 years of age. So Ezekiel, no doubt, had been training and looking forward to that time when he would get to be a priest and serve his God in that temple. But now he finds himself, in his own words here, among the captives by the river of Kabar. But God had a plan. God had not misplaced Ezekiel. God had not lost track where he was. Ezekiel was not there in that land of captivity because of some strange twist of fate. The point is, he didn't have to walk the marble, beautiful steps of Solomon's temple to be used of God, to minister to God's people. He may have felt he would never again be able to serve God, to be effective for God anymore. He would never again experience the glory of God. He would never again see the great power of God unleashed. After all, he was in captivity. But Scripture records that it was there that the hand of the Lord came upon him. There is where? In the land of captivity. It was there by the river of Kabar. It was there in Babylonian captivity that the Scripture says the heavens were opened and he saw visions of God. It was there, perhaps at his darkest hour, it was there when all hope seemed gone. It was there in his hour of crisis that the word of the Lord came expressly. Another translation says the word of the Lord came in reality to Ezekiel. May I tell you this morning that God knows exactly where you are, what's going on in your life, and He has promised, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. In Ezekiel's ministry, we find, when you read this book, at least six separate visions that Ezekiel received from God. Now, in this particular vision in chapter 37, the Holy Spirit brought Ezekiel in a vision to a valley filled with bones scattered over the ground as far as you could see. Now, this vision we're looking at here in this chapter is probably the one we're most familiar with in this whole book. Now, I know this vision was indeed speaking of and to the nation of Israel, but there's certain spiritual applications for you and me as well today. Now, as we study this passage, we see, first of all, the hopelessness of the situation. If ever a man was made to look upon an impossible situation, it was Ezekiel right here. These skeletons of corpses had undoubtedly been dead a long, long time. The end of verse 2 gives us a clue about that when it describes the bones as being what? Very dry. If Ezekiel had been taken to a valley filled with people who were dying, there would have been a glimmer of hope. Perhaps some would have been healed and survived and not even died. If the valley had been filled with corpses of people who had just died, there would still have been a glimmer of hope. There would have been the possibility of a mass resurrection. Even if the valley had been filled with complete skeletons, bones all intact, there might have been a glimmer of hope. But this valley was filled with scattered bones that were very dry. This points to the absolute hopelessness of the situation. There's only a remnant left of what once was. We realize that this vision given by God was to show the spiritual state of His people, the children of Israel. 19 times the Old Testament tells us that these people had gone, and I quote, a whoring after other gods. Go back to Deuteronomy chapter 30. Many years before this vision, God made a promise to these people, and it's found in Deuteronomy 30, verses 16 through 19. In that I command thee this day to love the Lord thy God, to walk in His ways, and to keep His commandments, and His statutes, and His judgments, that thou mayest live and multiply. And the Lord thy God shall bless thee in the land whither thou goest to possess it. But if thine heart turn away, so that thou wilt not hear, but shall be drawn away and worship other gods and serve them, I denounce unto you this day that you shall surely perish, and that ye shall not prolong your days upon the land, whether thou passest over Jordan to go to possess it. I call heaven and earth to record this day against you, that I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore choose life, that both thou and thy seed may live. God's people chose death. And the results are seen in this vision that Ezekiel had, the valley of the bones scattered that are very dry. Those people, that nation, had once been the most feared of all nations in the world, now lay in a heap of very dry bones. God always gives mankind a choice. His desire is to be a blessing to mankind, but He will not force His will on anyone. However, there are consequences to your actions and my actions. Choosing God's way brings life and blessing. That's what His Word says. Choosing to walk away from God, to ignore God and His commandments, brings destruction and death. The man and woman who choose to do their own thing, excluding God from all facets of their life, will find that they will become, spiritually speaking, a part of the valley of very dry bones. Maybe this is exactly how you feel this morning. You remember the joy that you used to have as a Christian. You remember how you once loved being in God's Word, reading it and studying it. You remember how you used to enjoy being in church and serving the Lord any way that you could. But now you feel so far away from the refreshing waters of His presence. You feel like you're dying in a dry valley. The Scripture makes it clear from a human perspective, there was absolutely no way there would ever be life there again. The bones again were very dry. No life remained in them. Listen to me, church. Each one of us need to have a great awakening to the condition of people who are without Jesus Christ. Without Christ, there is no hope. There is no life. There is no future. And until that becomes real to you and me, until we have a great compassion inside of the lostness around us, that people are going to split hell wide open, I'm telling you, my friends, there is no hope. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 12 tells us the unsaved, listen to this, are without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. That's in the New Testament, my friends. We need to have a picture in our heart and mind of the utter hopelessness of the situation. No human being, no earthly power could make those bones scattered over that valley come back to life. Having clearly in his mind the picture of a hopeless, helpless people without life, Ezekiel is asked by the Lord in verse 3. Look at the question. Son of man, can these bones live? Now God was asking, what do you think about it, Ezekiel? As you look out over that valley and bones scattered everywhere, and very dry bones at that, is this a hopeless situation? You see, the very asking of that question brought a glimmer of hope to Ezekiel the prophet. And he said, Lord, you alone know the answer to that. And that leads us to the second thought. God had a plan. Yes, indeed, God did have the answer that, as Ezekiel said, God's plan was a twofold plan. Listen to God's response to Ezekiel chapter 37, verse 4. Prophesy unto these bones and say unto them, O ye dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. The first part of God's twofold plan is the word of God. Life comes through His word. The Word of God can and does bring change in the life of an individual, the life of a church, the life of a family, the life of a community. His Word is life. Now in verse 7, look at what Ezekiel did. So I prophesied as I was commanded. And as a result of Ezekiel's preaching, the Word of God, something happens. He begins to see movement in that valley across those bones. God says something similar to us in our dry bone conditions too. When we're all dried up, feeling discouraged, and maybe even thinking it's hopeless, He says to us, get your Bible out and get in there and start reading it. Start studying my word. We object that it's not going to do any good. I've done it many times before, but He still urges us, get in my word, read it and study it. He calls on us not just to read it, but I want you to share my word. I want you to teach my word. I want you to preach my word. Again, we have our doubts. But that's what God calls on us to do. Look again at verse 7 of our text. And as I prophesied, there was a noise. And behold, a shaking. And the bones came together, bone to his bones. This is where that old Negro spiritual, dim bones, comes from. That's the truth. This right here. No, I'm not going to sing it. Don't worry about that. But listen. When we think about the Word of God, don't water it down. Don't try to improve upon it. Don't try to rationalize it. Don't feel you have to apologize for it. Simply get in the Word of God, read it, study it, meditate upon it, and share it. Simply share the Word of God as it is, just as the Lord God tells you to do. It's not our word, it's His word. Man, I'm telling you what, people today, they are more interested in trying to attract people with all kinds of means. My friends, if we'll just teach, preach, and live the Word of God, we'll make a difference in people's lives. I realize there will be many who will not want to accept what the Lord's Word says, but tell it anyway. That's what God asks you and me to do. The Word of God will always prove true. It'll always prove right, no matter what anyone says or does to the contrary. Now, I said God had a twofold plan. Number one was to get in the Word of God, read the Word of God. The second is found in verse 9 of our text. The second part of God's twofold plan is the Holy Spirit. You see, when we read verses 7 and 8, the bones looked alive, but they weren't. They weren't. It reminds me of those spoken of in the Bible as having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. There was a multitude there in that valley, but they were still dead. And they stayed that way until touched by the Spirit of God. May I tell you that all our efforts at trying to build up the kingdom of God are lifeless and powerless without the leading, working, and power of the Holy Spirit upon those efforts. Amen. All our programs, all of our projects, all of our promoting, all of our proddings are dead until energized by the Spirit of God. God's plan is found in the Word of God and in the Spirit of God. Finally, I want us to consider God's great promise. Look again at verse 5. The Lord says, I will cause breath to enter into you, and you shall live. Now in verse 5, I'm going to make you live. In verse 10, you find tucked in there, they live. Make no mistake about it, my friend. If God speaks it, it will come to pass. Amen. You see, this is not the only time that a graveyard tried to block and hinder the working and the promise of God. Over in John chapter 11, we're going to look at three different verses. First of all, verse 23 in that chapter. Jesus said unto Martha, thy brother shall rise again. Now, go on down in that same chapter to verses 43 and 44. And when he had thus spoken, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. And he that was dead came forth, bound hand and foot with grave clothes, and his face was bound about with a napkin. Jesus said unto them, loose him and let him go. Why did Jesus, standing outside the tomb of Lazarus, say his name? Why didn't he just say, come forth? Because I'll tell you, every grave in the world would have burst forth with believers. He had to be specific in that particular case. Lazarus, come forth. All right, let's go to Matthew chapter 28, verses 5 and 6. And the angel answered and said unto the women, fear not ye, for I know that ye seek Jesus which was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen as he said. Come, see the place where the Lord lay. What am I trying to tell you this morning? Simply this, when God promises you something, and his word is filled with promises that you and I as believers should and can claim each and every day, when God promises you something, he will bring it to pass. No situation is so bleak that it cannot be changed by the power of God. The valley of dry bones is a picture of the human race as a whole, exiled from God and their Creator, and dead in their trespasses and sins. To those cut off from God who have no hope, you and I who have been saved, we have the word of hope that they desperately need, the gospel message that talks about believing in the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. Can I ask you something this morning? Have you been saved? Are you a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ? Is everything all right between you and the Lord? If not, don't you want it to be? Don't you want to know if something should happen today? If death should come upon you very unexpectedly, that it's okay. It's okay because I've accepted Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. He has promised me eternal life and a home in heaven with him when my life on this earth is over. Don't you see how much God loves you? How much does God love you? This much. That's what Jesus did when he went to the cross. He stretched out his arms and he allowed them to nail him to that cross. He took your sins with him to that cross. He took my sins with him to that cross, making possible eternal life for whosoever will believe in him. If there's any desire within you right now to be saved, just as I'm talking about this, there's something inside you saying, you need to do that. You need to do that. Now, that's not Satan speaking to you. That's God's Holy Spirit. Satan would never tell you that. But God's Holy Spirit is speaking to you one more time, drawing you to salvation in Jesus Christ. The final choice is yours, though. You must repent of your sins and in faith ask Jesus Christ to come into your life and be your Savior. If you think that seems silly, think of Ezekiel and be glad you don't have to preach to a bunch of bones. God's word declares to us, you know this, my word shall not return unto me void. That's in Isaiah 55. All God is asked you and me as Christians, get in the word ourselves, absolutely, but share it. There's a lot of people who have no hope. And you may say, oh, that's silly. I've tried. I've given tracts. You keep plugging. You keep at it. This is God's word, and it's powerful. You never know what kind of an eternal impact it's going to make on somebody that you share it with. God's word will never fail to make an impact. Can these bones live? No situation is so bleak that it cannot be changed by the power of God. Bow with me if you will. All heads bowed and all eyes closed. You may be here today and God's Holy Spirit has spoken to you. And as you sit there, you know you're not saved. Maybe an adult, maybe a young person. Man, why not today? Why not today? Let go and let Jesus have control of your life. Christian, you may feel like you're in that valley. You may feel like you're in a hopeless situation. May this text remind you, God is always in control. All things are possible with God. Father, we just pray right now, as your Holy Spirit is at work, that Lord, your will would be done in lives this morning. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Let's stand together while we sing.